Hey, in this episode of Doc's Boost, we're going to talk all about starter problems. How to fix them, how to diagnose them, and make sure that you get the right part for the right issue the first time.
But before we get started, I want to thank Vinny out there in Pueblo, Colorado. He works for Colorado Tire Auto Care Center in Pueblo, Colorado on Eagle Ridge Boulevard. And I want to thank him for taking care of Peggy quickly and honestly while she was on vacation visiting family there in Pueblo. Our GL450 broke down and Benny came to the rescue and got her back on the road with an on-point diagnostic and repair. Thanks, Vinny. Now, back to the video.
So the symptom that I had to fix was turning the key to start, and all I heard was, but all the lights and everything came on normally. Hi, I'm Doc, and you're watching Doc's Boost, and Doc's Boost promises to deliver the truth about how to do high-performance maintenance, how to do high-performance upgrades and installs, and how to get out there and have some incredible high-performance fun and excitement with your ride. Dream it, upgrade it, and drive it like you stole it. So with all of the other things I checked being good, I jacked it up, got under the car, hit the starter with a hammer, and it turned right over.
Stop! That brings me to a myth that needs busting right now. Maybe, just maybe, that was true once decades ago. I think I remember my mom carrying a hammer around in our old freezer back in the day and smacked that starter when it acted up. Definitely, you can't do that today. The starters today have a lot of component parts in there and you can just shatter them if you smack it with a hammer. So stop doing that right now. But anyway, I did get away with it, and that led me to buy a starter that I didn't need.
So here's the new starter from Napa. It's brand new. No remanufactured starters for this car, and so this is the little puppy going in. So let's get this party started.
Yeah, I didn't need that starter, but I did install it, and I got one good start out of it, and nothing but clunks after that. God damn, what a nightmare. And you know how that works when you buy some electrical part, and once it's installed, you can't take it back. It's yours forever. Yeah, what a joke. All I did was check the battery voltage across the battery and made sure all connections to the battery and starter were clean and tight, then proceeded to install a starter I did not need. I'll show you how to R&R typical starter at the end of this troubleshoot and actual repair, because after all, a bad starter just might be what you discover during the process. The basic concept we're troubleshooting is just this. The ignition switch is placed in the start position. A starter motor request signal is sent to the PCM, and the PCM recognizes all the correct input signals from wherever they come in from, and there's more than just one, and it provides the starter relay coil with both voltage and ground. The starter relay contacts close, providing voltage to the starter solenoid, allowing the starter motor to activate. Now I have to assume a starting point for these tests, and that starting point is that you already know that a rapid succession of clicking indicates a battery or battery connection issue. You have to start with the known good, fully charged battery for any of these tests to mean anything. Before we proceed, please remember to follow the sequence of tests as presented. If you don't, there's a strong possibility of producing an inaccurate outcome, causing you to buy something you don't really need. So what you have to do is get out your digital multimeter and get ready to diagnose like a pro. A good battery must read no less than 12.5 volts across the terminals. If yours doesn't, charge it. If it can't maintain it, replace it. Right around 14 volts is the sweet spot. You might get a little bit more, like 14.5, 14.6, but anything over 14 is where you want to be. Check across the battery, then from positive terminal to the ground connection to the body of the car, usually near the battery somewhere, needs to be checked then, and those two readings need to match. If it doesn't, clean the battery connections and tighten the ground and retest. Once that's done, now check from the positive battery terminal to the starter housing. That must be the same as the battery voltage. If not, clean the ground connections and maybe even the starter to engine mating surfaces. If all good, continue to the relay in the fuse box. My relay is position number 52. Find and locate yours. Chances are, if you're getting a reaction from the starter, the relay is working. But let's go through this just to be thorough. Most relays follow the same pinouts, so using the picture as a guide, check for at least 10 volts at the shown location. And if you don't have the minimum voltage here, you must get a wiring diagram and follow and find the short. Now jump across the shown locations and the starter should react. If it does, the wiring from relay to solenoid is good. If you had 10 or more volts at the relay and jumping across the relay pinouts gets the starter to engage, but turning the key gives you no joy, then replace the relay and retest. Now let's move to the terminals on the starter. This is where you'll find yourself dedicating most of your time.
Okay, for reference point, I marked those cables and what they're going to be used for so you can see the voltage measurements without me being under the car. B is going to be battery. The M is going to be for this motor. And the S, of course, is for the solenoid. Okay, so when I hook up the meters to those wires, we're going to get a direct reading from my starter connected to the car. We're going to refer to those terminals throughout this video.
You must have 10 or more volts from B connection to the ground. If not, clean connections and retest. If you still don't have the proper voltage, replace the cable. If that's all good, jump from B to S to get the starter to engage. That would be the battery terminal to the solenoid terminal. If it engaged, all good. If not, replace the starter. If all good so far, check for battery voltage on the M connection. If yes, continue on. If no, replace the starter. All of those checkpoints were all about static check. You're just making sure voltage is where voltage is supposed to be. Now it's time to see what happens during start. And here's where things can get dramatic. With the meter connected to the solenoid and ground, turn the key to start. And the voltage should jump to 10 volts or more. If you passed all of the tests up to this point, hopefully you've done them in sequence, you shouldn't have to worry about passing this test at all. But if you didn't follow the instructions and do all the tests in sequence, go back to the relay jump test right now and see if you can make that happen. And going back to the relay jump test here, you don't pass. You need to check the wiring. You'll probably need a wiring diagram to figure out the wiring path of that solenoid wire and repair as necessary. Once you see the voltage jump to 10 volts, then move on. The next test is connecting the meter to the B connection to ground and turn the key to start. The voltage should not drop below 10 volts. Again, if it drops below the recommended voltage, clean all the connections and retest. If it's still below recommended voltage, replace the positive cable and then retest. If your car passed all the voltage checks that we've talked about, then replace the starter. Okay, so what was my real problem? After installing the starter I really didn't need and continued to suffer the no crank condition, I went through all of these tests that I just explained to you, which I should have did in the first place, and found my voltage on the B terminal. When the key was turned and trying to start the car, the voltage dropped pretty dramatic, almost to zero. A couple of tenths of a volt showed up on the voltmeter. Did that a couple of times, got the same result each and every time. And even though that cable was clean and tight and visually looked perfect, I replaced the cable and solved the problem. So obviously there was some sort of resistance buildup somewhere in that cable. So I do have a new starter on the car and the old one is in the bank, so to speak. So if the new one ever fails, I got another new one, or I got another known good one anyway. Now let me show you how to R&R a typical starter, because after all, after doing all of these tests, a new starter is just what you might need. So let's get the party started.
All right, so now we're gonna take the starter out. The first thing we're gonna do is take these two wire connections off. The battery connection comes off first. 14 millimeter stubby works best for me. That's off, move that out of the way. 10 millimeter stubby to take the solenoid wire off. And the wire comes off. 10 millimeter to get these three bolts out. We got a bolt here, and the bolt up around the back. And we're gonna use a 10 millimeter swivel attached to a couple of extensions, the 10 millimeter swivel socket, and we're going to attach it to the top first. And now running it out, and I'm holding it somewhat in place with the palm of my hand at the same time. All three bolts are out, and it's ready to drop. Always want to make sure the engine's not the problem in a no crank scenario. With a screwdriver, we can easily move the engine. See that? Now for the replacement of the new starter. We're going to feed the starter in. And get a bolt started. We got that one in, and the top one you can't see. Top one is all by touch. We're going to finger that one in. Just about all the way. Gonna go back in here, and we're gonna finger this one in with our 10 millimeter swivel, a couple of 3/8 inch extensions, and we're gonna do the top bolt first. Push the starter in place and run it up till it's ready to be tightened by the tool. We're gonna do that to all of them. And run that up. This tool back on the top and tighten that one first. And tighten that one up. There we go. Now it's good and tight. Now it's a matter of connecting the wires. Solenoid wire goes on first. A little stubby 10 millimeter ratchet wrench, and it's tight. So the next thing, get the battery cable on there. This one's a 14 millimeter. And we're done. All right, that's the installation process.
Now that you know how to troubleshoot starter issues like a pro and not get faked into buying some expensive part that you don't really need, take a look at this video right there that I got chosen especially for you. I'll see you there in a moment, and thanks for watching.